Let us come to Almighty God in prayer. Let us pray. How wonderful it is, O Lord, that your people can gather with their hearts joined in one accord to worship you and to praise you and to adore you. Especially, O Lord, as we remember our Lord's first advent and all that he did for us by coming into this world as a baby who journeyed to the cross. Lord God Almighty, we honor you, we glorify you, we worship you in spirit and also in truth. Speak to us today by your Spirit, O God, that we may grow in wisdom, in knowledge, in understanding, that we may be moved and inspired to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Scripture reading is taken from Galatians chapter 3, verses 23 to 29. But before the time for faith came, the law kept us all locked up as prisoners, until this coming faith should be revealed. And so the law was in charge of us until Christ came. in order that we might then be put right with God through faith. Now that the time for faith is here, the law is no longer in charge of us. It is through faith that all of you are God's children in union with Christ, Jesus. You were baptized unto union with Christ, and now you are clothed, so to speak, with the life of Christ himself. There is no difference between Jews and Gentiles, between slaves and free people, between men and women. You are all one in union with Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are the descendants of Abraham and will receive what God has promised. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for these his holy words. Amen.
Let us join in prayer. By the power of your Holy Spirit, O Lord, inspire us, move us, shake us, O Lord, interaction. Show us your vision, O Lord, for the world, that we, O Lord, who labor in your vineyard, who are co-partners with you in the establishment of your kingdom, may work more tirelessly. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength, our Saviour, and our Redeemer. Amen. The year 2020 has been a unique year in many ways. We are in the season of Advent. And Advent, as we know, we are reminded, it brings for us hope, peace, joy, and love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Yet we are starkly reminded that Jesus brings these things to us in a state of conflict, warfare even sometimes. My dear friends, today our society is witnessing an increase in an evil that is being described and called gender-based violence. As we look at what is happening in our nation, many of our women are being brutally murdered. Many of our women are being raped and killed. And it is in this environment that Christ comes to us again. Sometimes, my dear friends, we have to wonder, what is our role in all of this? Why is it men believe, for the most part, because most of the victims are women and the perpetrators are men, that they have the right to perform these dreadful acts on women, some of them whom they claim to love? It has to do with a false attitude that men have been socialized into believing about women. And one of these attitudes is one of ownership. In Trinidad, one of the first cases of domestic violence that led to murder, a man was taken to court. And while in court, he seemed to be confused as to why he was there. Why did they bring him to court? And he betrayed this attitude towards his wife by using these words in his own defense. Is my wife I kill? I didn't kill anybody else's wife. And so, my dear friends, this happened many years ago. And sadly, and unfortunately, it seems to be an attitude that still pervades our society, that our men still believe that women are their property to do what they want. But men are not the only ones to blame. Very often I have heard with my own two ears women saying, if he beat me, he love me. And of course, the victim is saying this. It tells us, my dear friends, how far we have to go. Sometimes even the Bible, the Word of God, is used to justify heinous acts against women. It is true that the Bible was written at a time when we existed in a mostly patriarchal society. Still today, there is some of that remaining. And perhaps the fact that the Bible was written in this patriarchal language, this male-dominated language, gives the impression that males should dominate. But my dear friends, a clear understanding of the Bible proves otherwise. You see, when we read the Word of God, from the very beginning, God made man in his image and likeness. But the word man used in the Bible from the Hebrew Adam means humanity. Also, when he made man in his image and likeness, we are told in Genesis chapter 1 that he made them male and female. When we continue to read the Bible, as we should closely, in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, we see many women playing very significant roles. The first one I want to share with you today is a name you probably never heard before, very obscure woman in the Old Testament, but who played a critical role. Her name is Jehosheba. She was the daughter of King Joram. She is known for saving her nephew while he was an infant. That nephew was Prince Joash, who they were planning to kill. His survival enabled the line of David and consequently the Messiah, Jesus Christ, to endure. And that was due to Jehoshua's bravery. She played a critical role in ensuring that Joash survived and the line of David from which Jesus came survived. A more popular name is Ruth. We all know of Ruth, the Moabitess, and how she left her home country and went with her mother-in-law, Naomi, and in her new homeland met a man by the name of Boaz, and how they too became ancestors of Jesus Christ. Again, Ruth played a significant role in ensuring that the lineage of Jesus Christ was maintained so that the prophecy may be fulfilled. Sarah. We all know of Sarah, the wife of Abraham, who, being unable to bear a child for a very long time, at a very old age, she gave birth to Isaac. Then after Ruth, we have Rachel, who became the wife of Jacob, who later would be known as Israel, the father of the 12 tribes. Then we heard in the Old Testament of Hannah, also childless for a long time, and who pleaded with God for her to have a son. And if God answered her prayer, she would dedicate him to God's glory. And so God allowed her to have a son whose name was Samuel, who became the very first prophet of Israel. And we all know of Eve. Yes, it is true that the Bible tells us that Eve gave in to temptation and she ate of the fruit and encouraged her husband to also eat of the fruit. But then we forget that Jesus was the mother of all living things, and it is she who would be the mother who would eventually produce in her generation the one who would do battle with Satan. We often hear of Samson and Gideon, judges. But do you know that there was a female judge as well, whose name was Deborah, who fought just as hard for Israel? And in Judges, we hear Deborah saying, "Certainly I will go with you, but because of the course you are taking, the honor will not be yours, for the Lord will deliver Sisera into the hands of a woman." Esther. Esther, who became queen of the nation of Persia. Esther, who used these words when the Jewish people were being threatened to be annihilated by the king because of a lie that was told to him. And Esther said something that perhaps we need to say from time to time. Maybe I am here for a time such as this. If I die, I die. And so we move to the New Testament, and we also come across women of substance in the New Testament. Mary, the mother of Jesus, whom, being a young lady who became pregnant, faced the consequences of her pregnancy. Then we know of Mary Magdalene, who, even though she came from a profession of ill repute, she became one of Jesus' strongest supporters and who never forsake him. She was always there. Then we hear of Elizabeth, who would become the mother of the forerunner of Jesus Christ. And then we hear of Mary and Martha, who belonged to a home with their brother Lazarus that Jesus often visited. And we heard how Mary would sit at Jesus' feet and cling onto every word that he said, while Martha played her role of providing for them. And then, my dear friends, we hear of Priscilla, the wife of Aquila, who played a vital role along with her husband when the church was established. And after many of the disciples of Jesus were killed or died, the task fell to Aquila and Priscilla to keep that church alive. We hear of Lydia, who was a businesswoman who sold purple cloth, and who, at a time when it was very dangerous to even identify with being a Christian, established a church in her home. And we are told that her whole family was baptized. My dear friends, all these instances in the Bible tells us of the important role that women played in the work of Almighty God, in the work of salvation, in the work of his kingdom. Perhaps because many of them did it quietly and in the background, we forget the importance of that work. We would remember also our Lord Jesus Christ himself and the relationship he had with women, where he honored even those who were considered to be among the least. We remember how he spoke to the woman at the well. She was a Samaritan. And so speaking to a Samaritan as a Jewish male and speaking to a woman was a great risk that Jesus took. But he honored her. We remember Jesus and how he went against what was normal in society for the sake of a woman caught in adultery, and how he treated her with honor and respect. And he said to her, "I do not condemn you, but go and sin no more." And then again, perhaps one of the greatest honors that Jesus paid to a woman was when an unnamed woman anointed him before his death with perfume from an alabaster jar that she broke, and she poured it on him, and she anointed him. She did for Jesus what none of his disciples did. And Jesus said of her that her story will be told forever. You see, my dear friends, we who are God's people must use the word of God to guide us in all matters. And with this matter of gender-based violence that is poisoning our society, and it seems to be getting worse, we need to be on the right side. You see, my dear friend, sometimes we misrepresent what God says in His Word. Sometimes we misunderstand what God says in His Word. One of the passages of Scripture that is used wrongly to justify husbands dominating their wives in a way that they should not comes to us from Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 22. Many persons quoting this passage of Scripture, all they say is, wives, submit to your husband. But they do not continue to read the rest of that chapter, where, yes, it does say, wives, submit to your husband as to the Lord. But it goes on to say, husbands, love your wives as Christ loves His church. And so, my dear friends, we must be truthful and honest as to what God wants of us. And St. Paul, once more in Galatians chapter 3, which was read to us, reminds us that there is neither male nor female in Christ. And so, my dear friends, the Bible clearly points us to the place that our attitude towards one another must be a one of equity and equality. Husbands do not own their wives, neither do wives own their husbands. Men and women are in partnership with God, because when God gave dominion over the world, He did not give it to the man alone. He gave it to men and women. As a church, my dear friends, we cannot remain silent on this issue. We need to speak out, and we need also to act. We need to educate our men, both within the church and outside of the church, men in the nation, as to their role in society and to their role in the family, that they are spiritual leaders who ought not to bully, beat, and maim those whom they claim to love. As we go through Advent, and as we remember the hope, the peace, the joy, and the love that Christ brings, we must be instruments of that hope, that peace, that joy, and that love, not only within the church, but in the wider society. We need to step up and step out to get rid of the scourge that is overtaking our land of gender-based violence. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
She craves attention. up. It's time we fight for change and justice and to protect all women and girls in society. End violence against all women and girls now.
End violence now.
Ever-present God, you have promised to be our Emmanuel, with us and among us. Our hearts are soothed as we hold on to the promise of your joy made complete in Jesus Christ. But Lord, the wait is not easy. Your people are suffering and crying out for justice. We hold in our hearts the cry of a woman who longed to sing out a song of praise like Mary, a song of justice and change. We long for a world where we don't have to live in fear and be chained by the systems of the greedy. Help us, O God, to be free. Lord, we think about those who are grieving, those who have experienced any kind of loss. Help us remember that in our silent nights, you are with us. You listen to our cries, you see our pain, and you will carry us through. Almighty God, this year, the Advent message certainly rings true as we are made to wait. We wait on medical breakthroughs, vaccines, healing, and recovery. So, Lord of all wisdom, as we wait for your wisdom to unfold in our lives, help us to find joy in the wait, to celebrate this life you have blessed us with, to cherish each moment, and to use every breath to worship and enjoy you. In this wait, may we be vessels of your hope, peace, joy, and love. In the name of Christ, who taught us to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we go with us. Remind us, O Lord, that it is you who made us male and female. It is you, Almighty God, who placed your spirit within us. Help us, O Lord, to act so that this scourge of gender-based violence will be destroyed. For it is not of you, O Lord. It is of the evil one. Lord, give us the strength and give us the commitment to work tediously to get rid of this scourge, this blight on the land of Trinidad and Tobago. And now may the Lord bless us and keep us. May he make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May he lift up his countenance upon us and grant us his peace, both now and forevermore.